A very good evening to one and all watching and listening to the second and final lecture in this series organized by the Department of English and Internal Quality Assurance Cell of Ramananda Centenary College. The lectures are an attempt to introduce two seminal texts that are included in the English Honours syllabus under Choice-Based Credit System, CBCS, followed by students of SKBU, Sidhu Kanu Birsa University, and other universities across the country. Dr. Chandan Dev, Associate Professor, JK College, had delivered the first lecture on 7th March in his inimitable style. Today's lecture will be delivered by yet another academic mission known to students across the districts of Purulia and Bankura. It therefore gives me great pleasure to welcome Dr. Shourabh Kumar Nag, Assistant Professor in English, Onda Thana Mahavidyalaya, on this occasion. Welcome, sir. I invite my colleague, Sanjeev Kumar Kaur, to introduce a stellar speaker for this evening to the audience. Over to you, Shonji.
Thank you, Arpita. Welcome, everyone. It's really a matter of privilege to me to have this opportunity to introduce esteemed professor, Dr. Shourabh Kumar Nag from the Department of English of Onda Thana Mahavidyalaya. Dr. Shourabh Kumar Nag is presently working as the HOD of the State Department 2 of Onda Thana Mahavidyalaya. He has earned much acclaim among students, scholars, and academicians from colleges and universities for his scholarly acumen. He has completed his PhD from the Department of English, Burdwan University in 2018. The thrust area of his dissertation was the spatial politics in select novels of Nyuhi Wa Thiong'o. He has delivered a number of lectures and presented a number of scholarly papers, research papers in various seminars and conferences in India and abroad. He has also published a number of prestigious articles too in a number of books and magazines, journals. The recent areas of his interest are modern and postmodern literature, American novels, feminist studies, gender studies, Indian English novels, postcolonial studies, Bengali literature, and translation studies. It's worthy to mention that at present he is engaged in translating some Bengali novels. And today he will deliver his lecture on Kalidasa's Avigyanam Sakuntalam. I strongly hope that his insightful lecture will help the students and scholars in the audience section to open up new vistas in Sanskrit literature. So without lingering anymore, I would request Dr. Shourabh Kumar Nag to go ahead with his deliberation. Over to you, Shourabh.
Thank you, Dr. Thank you, Professor Sanjeev Kaur. at the very beginning, and good afternoon to everyone. At the very beginning, I must acknowledge that I am greatly indebted to the Department of English, Ramananda Centenary College, Purulia, all the faculty members of the English department, especially Sanjeev Kaur. Sanjeev is like my younger brother. Secondly, I would like to extend my thanks to the Honorable TIC of the college, the organizing team, the members who are also engaged in the technical departments, because in order to organize such kind of web session, we need much technical equipment, you know. So my assignment today is Avigyana Shakuntalam. It's a pity that UGC took almost 65 years to incorporate ancient Indian literature in the UG syllabus for the students of English department. Nevertheless, this testifies to the urgency of unearthing the buried past, of remembering the Indian culture into the post-colonial framework of knowledge. Since this lecture is primarily oriented for the students, I have divided my lecture into a few segments and tried to tone down some of the complicated critical issues. So basically, this lecture is meant for a student, as I was told by the department. The segments are, at first I will discuss the genesis of Sanskrit drama, dramatic form. The second segment will be a kind of investigation into a kind of chronotopic discussion of Kalidasa. We shall try to locate him in temporal and spatial scenarios. Where and where was he born? Where and where was he writing his great texts? And the third segment will deal with the sources of Abhijnana Shakuntalam. The fourth segment will offer a general overview on the play. And in the fifth segment, I will discuss a few critical aspects that are intimately associated with the play Abhijnana Shakuntalam. Actually, the Sanskrit dramatic form, the problem is that there is no written evidence, or there is no history of Sanskrit literature written per se, that as a result, we are not very much sure about exactly when the first Sanskrit drama was written, for the first Sanskrit play was written. We have no direct testimony as to prove when and how the first Sanskrit play was written. But we can have some circumstantial evidences that will help us conclude that Sanskrit dramatic form emerged as a very dominant literary form long ago. There are some Western critics who suggest strongly that Sanskrit dramatic form was derived from the Greek dramatic form, that it was a kind of imitation of Greek drama, Greek plays. But such kind of assumption can hardly be true, because in the ancient texts, as ancient as the Ramayana, there are references, there are words that are connected with drama and dramatic form, such as not, noti, nortok. These words are mentioned in the Ramayana. In the Mahabharata, the dramatic art is praised. In the writings of Patanjali, Panini, we find the names of plays such as Bolibandha and Kangshabad. In the Natya Shastra, it has been said that Brahma created the Natya Vedas for the satisfaction of mankind. So we can conclude to some extent that Sanskrit dramatic form emerged in the maybe in the first century BC. Long before the birth of Jesus Christ, no question of Anglo-Saxon literature, no question of Anglo-Norman literature, as you can easily understand. So it's a very old dramatic form and very prolific dramatic form. It was well developed during its time. And when you read, I'm sure you have read the play of Abhijnana Shakuntalam, and you must know about the grandeur, the writing style of Kalidasa, the aesthetics of the poet. So it was not a kind of mediocrity in which the Indian Sanskrit pundits were engaged. It was a kind of very successful genre, and they were writing successfully. So successfully, so prolifically, so brilliantly, that even today we are reading them. So that kind of thing. Coming to Kalidasa, the first thing that strikes me while teaching Abhijnana Shakuntalam and Kalidasa in my classes is his name. Isn't very peculiar that Kalidasa has no surname? He's just Kalidasa. If we divide his names, we shall get Kali and Dasa. Now, apparently, the name has religious suggestions because we know that Kali is the Hindu goddess. So Kalidasa, the meaning of the name may be translated as a worshipper or a slave to goddess Kali, or a worshipper or a devotee of Kali. But the word Kali has another suggestion, another connotation, because the word Kali is derived from Kala. Kala means time. So the name Kalidasa is religious as well as secular, because he is not just the slave to goddess Kali, he is not just a devotee to goddess Kali, he is also a devotee of time, he is also a slave to time. So a very important and very interesting and curious name Kalidasa is. Now coming to his time, now coming to the place and time of Kalidasa, the when Kalidasa and where Kalidasa was born, there are speculations, endless speculation among critics and scholars of Kalidasa. Okay, I forgot to share my screen. Just hold. Let me. One sec. I hope the screen is visible to you. So as we were discussing the time of Kalidasa, there is a popular Bengali poem written by Rabindranath Tagore. I'm quoting from that poem in Bangla. Hai re kobe kete geche Kalidasher kal, Ponditera bibad kore loye tarik shal. Kalidasher kal onedin age kete geche, but even today we are debating about that the time, the chronotopic situation of the poet. Actually, Sir William Jones, a Western scholar, he asserts that Kalidasa probably appeared in the first century BC, and they particularly mentioned a kind of year, that kind of century, that was the 57th BC. That means the first century BC, and obviously there is opponent, there is antagonistic views about the claim, and there are critics who do not accept the time to be Kalidasa's time. There is a popular story about Kalidasa, that Kalidasa was one of the nine gems, Navaratna, in the court of Vikramaditya, but this theory is also refuted to be wrong, because the time of Vikramaditya's kingship and Kalidasa's writing style do not match. Very surprisingly, Kalidasa has never cared about himself. He has nowhere written about himself. Okay, so that is the reason why Kalidasa is so controversial. There are other opinions of other historians and literary critics, and they suggest that Kalidasa may be writing or might be writing in the 75th BC. So you see that there is no fixed opinion about the man. And I am reminded of another mystery from English literature, and his name is William Shakespeare. You know, even today we are confused who Shakespeare was. People also say that Kalidasa was not a single poet. Kalidasa was the name of a number of poets. That means there were many Kalidasas at that time, just like there are very many Valmikis at that time. The Valmiki we read, we think that he is the one and only Valmiki, but modern researchers are saying that there were many Valmikis like that. There were many Kalidasas writing at that time, and there were many poets who were not really Kalidasas, but they were writing under the name of Kalidasa as well to be famous. Okay, there are many interpolated texts that that are supposed to be written by Kalidasa, but in reality they were written by some mediocre poets during his lifetime. So you see that the debate will never end, it will continue. So let us talk about the geographical location, the geographical situation of Kalidasa. I have promised to offer you a chronotropic discussion on that thing. So Kalidasa, according to some, wrote in a specific style that is called the Vaidharbhi Riti, Vaidharbhi style, and Vidharbha was in the South India. So it may be that Kalidasa was born in the South India, maybe, or it can also be that Kalidasa was really one of the nine gems in the court of Vikramaditya. I don't know. Critics debate endlessly, and there is no end to that debate. Now we must talk about the sources before I deal with the text. The primary sources of Abhijnana Shakuntalam are the Ramayana. These are the primary sources, as you can see on your screens: the Ramayana, Katahari Jatak, Padma Purana, and the Mahabharata. Though in these texts, the story, the action of the story, or the plot of the story, actually closely resembles the plot of Abhijnana Shakuntalam, but all incidents are not obviously adopted or imitated. Abhijnana Shakuntalam is an independent play. Kalidasa was definitely inspired by the texts, but of course it's an original creation of Kalidasa. Okay, for example, we have metaphorical affinities with the Ramayana. For example, in the Ramayana, Rama was separated from his wife Sita. In Abhijnana Shakuntalam, Dushvanta is separated from his wife. There is reunion in Ramayana towards the end of the epic. There is reunion in the last act of the play. In this way, we have some kind of metaphorical affinities with the Ramayana. In Katahari Jatak, the protagonist loses his consort and is reunited at the end. Padma Purana also has some kind of metaphorical resemblance or semblance with the plot of the Abhijnana Shakuntalam. I'm not going into the details. We have very limited time. And the last one, the Mahabharata. In the Mahabharata, we have some sort of a different version of the tale. What happens in the Mahabharata is that Shakuntala lost her ring, and when she came to the court of Dushvanta, and she claimed that she was his lawful wife, and the child Bharat was born at the time. The child was Dushvanta's child, and it was his lawful child. Dushvanta remembered everything, but he was scared of accepting the kind of lawless, whimsical love story that he was involved in. And in the presence of his courtiers, he was ashamed of acknowledging Shakuntala as his wife. Okay. And then he heard some divine sound, divine voice from the sky. We know in Bengal it's called Doibobani, and that Doibobani, that divine voice, confirmed that Bharat was Dushvanta's child and Shakuntala was his wife. And then he accepted both Bharat and Shakuntala in his court, and the story ends here. But you see that Kalidasa has modified the story, and he has introduced two, three tropes, motifs, symbols to enrich the play. And Dushvanta and Shakuntala are reunited only at the end of the play, after many ups and downs in their lives. Now, Abhijnana Shakuntalam, the title of the play is very interesting. The title has two words, actually. The title Abhijnana Shakuntalam, if we break the title, we shall have two words. One is Abhijnana, another is Shakuntalam. Abhijnana means recognition. Okay, and Shakuntalam, you know, it's from Shakuntala, and I know that you know about the significance of the name Shakuntala, because Shakuntala was the daughter of Menaka, and she was left by her mother, and some birds took care of her. They covered Shakuntala with their soft feathers, and that's why she was named Shakuntala later. She was actually recovered from under the feathers of birds, and that's why she's called Shakuntala. Now, in this play, you see the title of the play. If you notice it closely, it says the recognition of Shakuntala. That means it's about the recognition of a woman. Today we speak of the identity of woman, we speak of gender identity, we speak of recognition, we speak of empowerment of woman. You shall find everything, every element in the play, and you see that though it was a male dominated society at that time, I will talk about it later, because many believe that the recognition of Shakuntala is a kind of marginalization of Shakuntala, but it is not. I will show you why it is not. And Kalidasa emphasizes on the prestige of the lady, prestige of the woman, because here Shakuntala is not a weak mother depending on the whims of the gods and goddesses when they will send the divine message to the king, but she speaks her mind. When you will go through the text, you will see that Shakuntala is a very strong woman. Okay, I will discuss these things later on when I will discuss the critical aspects. Now, the title, you see that the title says everything, and we understand that we are going to read about the recognition of Shakuntala. Before going into the brief overview of the play, I would like to speak about the Nandi, a kind of prologue that ushers the poem, that introduces the poem. A Nandi in Sanskrit dramatic literature is a kind of invocation to some divine god or goddess, and the poet actually invokes the god or goddess or any divine power for aid and assistance so that he may successfully compose the text. In the Nandi, that is translated as benediction by the translator, I have that Penguin edition that was translated, that the play was translated by Chandra Rajan. I have that translation with me. I mentioned the name so that it may be easier for you to follow the right kind of text. In the benediction, actually, Shiva is invoked. Why I'm talking about it? It actually determines the religious orientation of Kalidasa. In many of his texts, Kalidasa is found to invoke either Kali or Shiva. In most cases, Shiva. So there is no doubt that Kalidasa was a Shaivo or a devotee of Lord Shiva. Now, today, our idea of Shiva differs from the idea of Shiva in the Vedas, because Shiva is supposed to be formless. Shiva is timeless. Shiva is never born. Shiva never dies. And you know that in no Puranas, there is a story on Shiva's birth. Nobody knows when he was born. Actually, Shiva cannot be born, because Shiva is the elements. Actually, the word Shiva, in Bengali, it is Sha, Talebosho. And that Sha actually means the void, the space, the chaos. Okay. So Shiva is the space, the infinity that can never be born. Because object can be born, object can be destroyed, but space cannot be created, space cannot be destroyed, you know. And space precedes the objects. Okay, it comes before the object, and the space is more important than the object because the space holds everything. If there is no space, the objects cannot be situated. Okay, so that's why Shiva, the space is worshipped by Hindus for ages. And in that Nandi, the eight forms of Shiva are mentioned, that Shiva manifests himself in eight forms, such as water, fire, priest, sun, moon, space, earth, air. These are the eight types of manifestations of Shiva. That emptiness, that vast abyss manifests itself through these elements. If you read the Vedas, Rig Vedas, if you read Vedas, you must know that the elements are worshipped at the very first chapter, especially fire. Because we in ancient India believed that elements are divine, because it's the element that creates us, that composes us. We are a composition of five elements according to that Hindu Puranas. Okay, five elements, though the Western theologians believe that, or Aquinas in Summa Theologica, I said that we are composed of four elements. They don't believe in the sky. Okay, the play begins, the act one begins with a conversation between the Suta and the king. And it begins with a hunting scene that is very, very symbolic for the play, because Dushvanta has come in a forest close to the vicinity of the hermitage of Kanna, and he has come there to hunt. Now the question is, he has come to hunt deer. And obvious pun on the word deer is there. Whom actually is he hunting? Is he hunting a deer, D-double-E-R, or is he hunting deer Shakuntala? Because from the very beginning, there is not a single sentence in the play that shows that Shakuntala is spiritually inclined, Dushvanta is spiritually inclined towards Shakuntala. Rather, he is intrigued by her physical beauty. There are so many lines from the very beginning. It's only after the separation and after many years have elapsed, after the rediscovery of the ring from a calf's belly, that Dushvanta's spiritual love for Shakuntala is awakened. Okay. So from the very beginning, Kalidasa has prominently suggested that the man is intrigued, the man is arrested by the physical beauty of the woman, of a forester. I'm quoting from Act 1. It's with rounded breast, concealed by cloth of bark, fashioned at the shoulder in a fine knot. Her youthful form, enfolded like a flower, in its pale leafy sheath, unfolds not its glory. There is another description of Shakuntala. Her lower lip has the rich sheen of young shoots. Her arms the very grace of tender twining stems. Her limbs enchanting as a lovely flower, glow with the radiance of magical youth. So from the very beginning, you see that there is not a single word on Shakuntala's spiritual makeup, but rather her on her physicality, on her physical beauty, on her blooming youth, etc. So one thing we may be sure of from this is that initially Dushvanta was attracted by the beautiful physical makeup of Shakuntala. Okay, now as we start reading, we shall see that Dushvanta is hunting the deer, and at the same time he is hunting the woman. Okay, he is a polygamous man who had multiple wives, and the addition of one more does not matter to him. In the second act, we find Madhavya, Madhavya very very freely talking to his friend and king and master Dushvanta. Madhavya is the fool, the court jester. The concept of fool, you know, you have read, I hope you have read Shakespeare. In Shakespearean plays, we have the character of fool, and those of you who have read, you know that Shakespearean fools are not really foolish, be it Touchstone or the fool in King Lear or Yorick in Hamlet. The fools are sometimes they are wiser than those who are not so foolish. So but in Abhijana Shakuntalam, the dimension of Madhavya is very much like that, because Madhavya is the court jester of Dushvanta. He now and then mocks, and he actually criticizes the king, he rebukes the king, but at the same time he criticizes the king's wrong actions, and he has very good sense, you know. Madhavya's speech, actually, the first speech of Madhavya at the very beginning of Act 2 shows how much he hates the forest life. And this speech reminds me of Jack's speech in As You Like It. You know that Jack's was equally bored with that forest life, and later Touchstone also supported Jack's. In Act 3, we are at the hermitage of Kanna, and Shakuntala and the king, they are deeply in love, it's said, and they meet a number of times, hiding themselves from the elders. And the two friends of Shakuntala, Priyambada and Anushwa, are also a great help to her. They are trysts, multiple times trysts, actually multiple trysts. They assist their dear friend Shakuntala. Now Priyambada and Anushwa play a crucial role in the play, and often they play the role of chorus. They play choric roles. You know that in Greek drama, chorus was a group of singers who used to comment on the present action, criticize, that is, evaluate the past and anticipate the future. Thus, they actually tried to connect the audience with the characters on stage. That means in Greek plays, the chorus performs the role of mediator. In this play, Priyambada and Anushwa also perform the role of mediators. Sometimes they ventilate questions that come to our mind. Sometimes they criticize something that we want to criticize. That means as if they are the representatives of the audience as well as of the readers. And in this act, actually, I forgot one thing, that is the curse on Shakuntala. You know the story that Shakuntala was very much wrapped in the thought of Dushvanta. And she was, actually Dushvanta left the hermitage long ago, and she did not return after a long time. And Shakuntala was very much wrapped in his thought. And she was thinking whether the man will return or not, etc., etc. In the meantime, Durvasa, very powerful and very short-tempered saint, he visited the hermitage of Kanva in Kanva's absence, but Shakuntala did not listen to listen to his call, and he became angry and he cursed her. Now I'm not going into the curse, but I want to discuss the thing as an important trope introduced by Kalidasa in the play. In the Mahabharata version of the tale, there is no curse. Now the question, obvious question that comes to our mind is that why did Kalidasa introduce that curse thing? Okay, just hold one second. I'm very sorry. I was talking about the curse. In the Mahabharata, the curse is not mentioned. Why did Kalidasa mention the curse? Why did he introduce the trope? If you see, you will find that in the play, Dushvanta will forget Shakuntala. And who is responsible for that? That's the curse. The curse is responsible for that. Many critics, many feminist scholars also, they assert that Kalidasa introduced the curse to bypass the responsibility of the king, that the king actually forgets because of the curse, and that is why he fails to recognize Shakuntala. So this is that curse is a kind of phallic trope, phallic metaphor in the play that actually destroys the happy future of Shakuntala. Okay, Shakuntala was cursed that she will be forgotten by the man whom she was thinking about. And in the next act, Shakuntala is sent by Kanva to her in-law's house, that is the court of Dushvanta. The scene of Shakuntala's departure is very painful, and I will come back to that scene also when I will deal with the theme of nature-man symbiosis in the play. So Shakuntala, while leaving the hermitage of Kanva, a little deer was tugging at Shakuntala's sari. It's really a painful scene, and it gives you the feeling that that some sister or someone very dear to you is leaving for her in-law's house when you even read the play. If you do not watch it acted before your eyes, even if you read the play, you will have that kind of feeling. Kalidasa's writing style is so lively that you will have that feeling. And Shakuntala, while on her way to the court of Dushvanta in Sachi's pool, she will lose the ring, and she will accidentally drop the ring, but she won't know about it. She does know that the ring is lost. So in the court scene, you know that when Dushvanta refuses to accept her, she claims to have the token of love that he gave her long ago, and Dushvanta demanded that, but she could not fetch it because it was not with her anymore. So she was proved to be a liar, and she was immediately rebuked by the king. But the royal priest suggested the king that she might stay with me because she was pregnant. It would be unholy, it would be ruthless for a king to banish a pregnant woman. So she might stay with me, and after the birth of a child, I will know automatically with the help of astrological wisdom, whether the child is fated to be a Raj Chakravarti king or not. If he is fated to be a Raj Chakravarti king, then she is your wife. But you know that Menaka sent her friend to take Shakuntala far away from the court of Dushvanta, and Shakuntala was taken away by the friend of Menaka. Her name is Mishrakeshi. And then we find Shakuntala in Act 7 in the ashram of Maricha in the foothills of the Himalayas. The king was returning from heaven, from the abode of Indra, after defeating some giant, some monster. And on his way back, he decided to visit the ashrama of Maricha. And then he saw a little boy, you know, Sarvadamana, playing with a lion. The boy was no ordinary boy. He was very strong-willed and very much determined. Even the Harmeet woman, they Harmeet ladies could not take him away, separate him from the lion cub, and in a kind of catechistic session, question after question, one after another, Dushmanta gradually comes to know that the little boy's mother's name is Shakuntala, and then Shakuntala appeared, and there is the reunion. That is the general theme of the play. But this theme actually gives us two, three important suggestions, two, three important topics of discussion, and for our personal critical meditations as well. I will discuss the themes one after another. The first thing that is the presentation of nature. In the play, actually, nature is like a character. Nature is as powerful as a character. In the first act, we have the description of nature as something very lively, something very animating. For example, they talk about the prospect of marriage between the mango and the vanayotsni, that is the jasmine. So the tree, one tree is married to another tree. Okay, as if they are very close to the human world. Okay, nature is not a kind of external surrounding thing. Nature is very, very close, very intimate, as if they take part in the life of man, and we are also engaged in a way, as if we are the relatives of nature and they are our relatives, like that. Then the reference to the deer, the roe, the other animals you see, and Shakuntala is represented as a mother figure. She looks after the deer very carefully. There, in one scene, a deer is orphan. It has lost its mother. And since its birth, Shakuntala has taken care of it. She has brought it up. She has anointed it with ingudi oil, etc. And the deer is very close to Shakuntala. This kind of man-nature coexistence is beyond any kind of possibility, beyond thought in today's civilization. You know, though we speak about ecocriticism, ecological consciousness today, many other things, the preservation of nature, ecosystem, etc. But that kind of symbiosis is really brilliant, unthinkable. When Shakuntala was about to depart the hermitage of Kanva, she was gifted by different trees different things. Some tree gifted her with gems, some tree gifted her with a cloth, some tree gifted her with a kind of, or should I say, a kind of vermilion. So different trees gift Shakuntala different presents, and Shakuntala was ready for her in-law's house, for her departure. This kind of nature-man symbiosis is disrupted the moment we are introduced to Dushmanta's court. The moment Shakuntala reaches the court, harmony is replaced with cacophony. Peace is replaced with conflict. Innocence is reflected with politics and diplomacy. Shakuntala is brutally rejected, insulted by the king. But the moment Shakuntala left the court, Dushmanta mused all alone that he was feeling attracted to the woman, and he should have kept her. That kind of passages are also there in the play, and actually it actually reveals the nature of Dushmanta. Dushmanta, I don't find him a very good king, or a very good king with a golden character. I don't find him any reason to glorify his stature, though he is a friend of Indra, and he visit Swarga to fight with the monsters. But as a human being, Dushyanta is very diplomatic, very meticulous, very whimsical, and to some extent, perverted. The next topic of discussion, critical discussion from the play, is the society. We have a kind of mirror. The play is a kind of mirror of the contemporary society. I was talking about the conflict between court and forest. And you know that the moment Shakuntala reaches the court of Dushyanta, she faces a number of difficulties. She faces. Later on, when the ring was discovered from the belly of the carp, an innocent fisherman was tortured by two policemen, Suchaka and Janaka. And later, the king intervened and rescued the man. Otherwise, the man was being beaten. He was condemned as a thief. He was condemned on false charges by the policeman. The court is the place where the king's wife sings tragic songs, songs of separation, songs of oblivion. The king does not care for Hamshabati. She sings pitifully. The court is a place where a pregnant woman is brutally insulted. And forest is a place where you have love, where you have innocence, where you have fellow feeling. A little boy is torturing a lion cub. And the mother of the lioness, does not come and eat the boy. This kind of man and nature symbiosis is present in the forest. So you see that we have that kind of society. It was a polygamous society in which a man was free to marry multiple times. A kind of and Gandharva marriage was also a norm in which the guardians, the parents of either of the bride or the groom, they had no part at all. If the man and the woman agreed to marry, they could agree, etc. It was a time when the great munis and rishis, they used to offer prayer and oblation to the gods. Generally speaking, it was a very religiously, very secure society where people were safe and secure in the hand of religion. Okay, now the third part, that is the chorus, the role of Priyambada and Anushua as chorus in the play. Actually, when the play starts, we have a Suta. We have a Sutradharo, actually, Sutradhara, not Suta, Sutradhara. Sutradhara or chorus, actually, chorus can be translated into Bengali as Sutradhara. Sutra means the link. The link, it may be the dramatic link, it may be the link between the act, the characters on stage and the audience. Sutradhara, and he actually begins the play. But when the play begins, we find that Priyambada and Anushua, they are important characters, but they also perform choric roles. Many of their speeches express our questions. I have already told you. I am just quoting 2-3 lines from the play so that it may be of help for you. For example, in the very first act, Shakuntala is talking to Priyambada and Anushua. "See, my friends, the mango tree is over there, fluttering his finger of tender leaf sprays as if beckoning to me. I shall go over to him." "Dear Shakuntala, stand there for a moment." "What for?" With you beside him, the mango looks as if wedded to a lovely vine. Think about the imagination. Shakuntala is compared to a lovely vine. She is the embodiment of nature. And maybe Kalidasa is suggesting that such beautiful nature, such beautiful, such peaceful nature is disrupted. The tranquility is violently challenged when the king comes to hunt the innocent deer. There is a reference to a mad elephant towards the end of Act 1, probably, as far as I can remember. We can compare Dushyanta to that mad elephant. Just an elephant destroys everything. Dushyanta comes and destroys everything. The leaves are covered with the dust. The place is filled with cacophony of his hunters, the sound of the gong, etc. The situation becomes so bad that a tapasa of the hermitage, a young hermit, requests the king to put down his bow and arrow. And he reminds the king that the duty of the king is not to kill the innocent, but to protect the innocent. So probably this play is also a critique of the male domination. Critique of the male domination. And Shakuntala is given voice. She is not marginalized in the play. She is given voice. For example, if you discuss the court scene in which Shakuntala is being rejected by Dushyanta, she blazes up like fire. She blazes up. And she drastically rebukes the king for insulting her. She does not surrender to the king. She does not bow down to the king for mercy, for pity. She is a strong-willed, she is an empowered woman in the play. She's not dependent on the words of the gods and goddesses, their pity, no. She speaks her mind. And if Dushyanta is not ready to accept her, she manages to bring up her child all alone in the hermitage of Maricha. So you see, this kind of portrayal of a woman is praiseworthy, because Kalidasa was writing in a time when such kind of empowerment of woman, the freedom of woman, the equality, etc., the feminist terms, you know, people did not talk about these things. Society was basically a patriarchal society. So the portrayal of Shakuntala really is really praiseworthy. Okay, I was talking about their choric roles. I simply diverted from it. Priyambada and Anushwa, they commented on many action of the play. They anticipated the future also. At times they helped their friend. For example, when Durvasa cursed Shakuntala, and Shakuntala even did not notice it, Priyambada and Anushwa, they did their best to solicit Durvasa to revoke the curse, but it was not possible, you know, but he gave them a solution. The next topic of discussion is maternity. I think I have touched the topic. Maternity is an important issue in the play, because you know that according to Durvasa's words, Shakuntala will be recognized with the help of the token of love, a kind of remembrance. And if the ring fails to do the thing, we can compare Bharata also to a remembrance. Bharata is a token of memory, symbolically, of course. After seeing the ring that the fisherman discovered from the belly of the cart, the king remembered everything. But the final recognition came only after the king saw Bharata. So metaphorically, Bharata played the role of a kind of Avijnana. He's a metaphorical representation of that Avijnana. And maternity is an important issue because except Bharata, Dushyanta had no male issue from any of his wife. And at the end of the play, towards the end of the play, in the final act of the play, Dushyanta accepts Shakuntala. Who knows that he's accepting because he's compelled to do so, because he has no one to inherit him. He has no one to look after his kingdom after him. So it may be a kind of compulsion on the part of the king. That's why he finally accepted Shakuntala. He had no male heir, you see. So maternity is a very important issue in the play. The next issue, the next issue is court versus country. I have already touched the issue, court versus country, in the play. The two worlds are placed side by side, as Shakespeare, you remember, Shakespeare did it in As You Like It. We have the two places, the dramatic action fluctuates between the court and the country. And in Shakespeare's As You Like It also, the court is presented as a place of comfort, but at the same time, as a place of corruption. It is the court where Oliver deprives Orlando, and it is the country where the foresters live happily. So the conflict between court and country, you know, this is also present in the play. I have discussed it in details. Finally, the character of Shakuntala that should be thrown some light. Shakuntala, you see, from the very start, one thing about Shakuntala attracts our notice is that Shakuntala is ill-fated from her birth. She was given birth by an apsara, that is Menaka, and she was not brought up by her mother. When the play begins, we are informed by Anushwa and Priyambada that Kanva has visited Somatirtha, a kind of pilgrimage, to propitiate the adverse fate of Shakuntala, you know. That means Kanva knew in advance that Shakuntala's married life may be tragic. So he visited Somatirtha, he undertook that kind of pilgrimage to propitiate the ill fate of Shakuntala. Then the king came and fell in love with Shakuntala, and they are united. Then the king left, you know, and Shakuntala again faced separation when she went to the court for recognition. She was denied recognition, and she was taken away from the court by Mr. Keshi to the hermitage of Maricha, where she gave birth to Bharata, and she then brought him up. The character of Shakuntala closely resembles the character of Sita in the Ramayana. And while reading about the tragic life of Shakuntala, many of us will be reminded of Sita's trials all through her life. Even when Ram rescued her from Ravana's country, even then there was a trial. Sita was put to trial again because his subjects were not ready to accept her as their queen. Her purity was put in question. Second thing, Shakuntala is very beautiful. There are hundreds of passages that glorify her beauty, her unmatched beauty. Okay. Thirdly, Shakuntala is an embodiment of nature. Many times, Shakuntala and nature are compared. For example, there is one particular area where Shakuntala says, Anushwa says, that I heard Kanva saying that when the jasmine will bloom, Shakuntala will be married. So you see that chaand utheche phul phuteche chhatratalay ke phul phutle biye hoy, as if jasmine will bloom, and the blooming of jasmine is directly connected with the marriage of Shakuntala. That kind of connection is built between Shakuntala and nature. I have already talked about how nature loves her, how nature benevolently gifted her at the time of going to her in-law's house, you know. So Shakuntala can be called an embodiment of nature. She may be a metaphor for nature in the play. If we read the play as an allegory, then Shakuntala may be, the character of Shakuntala may be read as an allegory, because you know that the court is always, the court will always reject pure nature. The court will welcome urbanization. The court will welcome development. It will always reject nature. Shakuntala is rejected. But at the end, when the necessity of nature is understood, nature is accepted, nature is embraced. But this acceptance, this reconciliation happens, that is quite interesting, outside the court. It's not that Dushmanta and Shakuntala are reconciled inside the court. They are reconciled in the hermitage of Maricha. Okay. Okay, I hope that the time is up. Yes. And I have to call it a day. I have to end the session. It was really a pleasant session. And I once more thank you, all the faculty members, for organizing the web session. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Nag, for this wonderful session. And this was very exhaustive, actually. I mean, in the sense that you've covered so many areas, especially you tried to locate Kalidasa in a particular time period, which I think is very useful for the students at this stage, because we usually tend to go straight into the story and sort of not give any background to it. So your lecture was very insightful in that sense. We have a few questions from students. I'll put them up on the screen for you to answer, and then maybe you can take them up. Yeah.
Okay. Actually, I have already given the answer to the question in my lecture. Dushmanta did not forget Shakuntala. Actually, Dushmanta was hesitant to accept her, because you know that Dushmanta and Shakuntala love story happened outside the court. And among his courtiers, the king did not understand whether he should accept her. And another thing was also there. Shakuntala was pregnant. Okay. It was actually against the ethics at the time. You know that ethics change. According to the ethical point of view, from the ethical point of view, Dushmanta was hesitant to accept a woman when she was pregnant. Okay, because he did not know who the father was. So he actually did not forget Shakuntala. He was hesitant to accept her. And when he heard that Daivavani, then he accepted Shakuntala. Okay. If the Kars episode not happen, no, I did not say that Kars episode did not happen in Abhijnana Shakuntala. I said that the Kars episode did not happen in the Mahabharata. Of course, there is the Kars of Durvasa in Abhijnana Shakuntalam. But in its original text, the epic, the Mahabharata, there is no Kars, actually. Kalidasta ke upadhi moto chilo. Actually, I don't understand your question. Probably you want to ask if Kalidas was the surname. I don't know. Actually, you know that Kalidasa whether Kalidasa was a surname or Dasa was a surname. It can be that Dasa was a surname. Even today, there are people with Dasa surname. I don't know whether he was Kalidasa or Kalidasa. Okay. And Abhijnana, yes, you commented on the word Abhijnana. Abhijnana actually means recognition. Abhijnana means recognition. In the play, eventually, the recognition comes from a kind of token of memory. Token of memory. As you know that Abhijnana, we can refer to the Aadhaar card for your understanding. The Aadhaar card. Today, we have Aadhaar card to prove our identity. I am XYZ, son of XYZ, you know. But at that time, there was no Aadhaar card. So the tragedy was written. Actually, it's not a tragedy. It's a comedy. But the tragedy happened actually to Shakuntala. Whether Vishwamitra was Brahmin or no. No, Vishwamitra was not a Brahmin, you know. He was not a Brahmin.
All right, so if that is all, I would now like to invite my colleague Hriday Roy to officially thank Dr. Nag. Hriday.
Good evening, sir.
Hi.
Good evening, to you. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
So before giving you formal thanks, I'd like to ask a question as I teach the same topic in my college.
Okay, please.
There is a speech of Matali towards the end of the play where he says that it is the twine sprung from Daksha and Marichi, but one removed from the creator, whom the seers extol as the cause of the effulgence that manifests itself in 12 forms. He begat the protector of the triple worlds and ruler of the gods, offered oblations. In whom the world self, higher even than the self born, placed itself to be born into the world. This is in the final of the play.
Could you please tell me the page number? The sound does not come very clear.
Okay. It is 278 in my book.
Okay, 278. Are you talking about? Are you talking about this speech? Is this the twine sprung from?
Yes. If you kindly illumine this speech.
Okay. Is this the twine sprung from Daksha and Marichi, but one removed from the creator, whom the seers extol as the cause of the effulgence that manifests itself in 12 forms, who begat the protector of the triple world, and ruler of the gods, offered oblation, in whom the world self, higher even than the self, born, placed itself to be born into the world. And this is the speech of Dushvant, as you see. Yes, it is actually uttered in reply to Matali's praise. Lord of the earth, the parents of the universe regard you with eyes that reveal the affection for a son. Approach them, your honor, etc. And then the king replied that, is this the twine sprung from Daksha and Marichi, but one removed from the creator, whom the seer extol as the cause of the effulgence that manifests itself in 12 form, who begat the protector of the triple world and ruler of the god of our oblation, in whom the world self, even the self born, placed itself to be born into the world. Actually, the king is referring to the divine creation here. This speech can be called a kind of worship, a kind of invocation to the creator. Okay, and the 12 forms, you can see the 12 forms are referred to here. These are the divine forms. These are the 12 divine forms of the creator that the king is referring to, who begat the protector of the triple world. Triple world refers to the Swarga, Marta, and the hell, that is the Naraka. These were the triple worlds, the three worlds. Ruler of the gods offered oblation, in whom the world self, higher even than the self, born, placed itself to be born into the world. Two selves are talked about. One is the world self, another is the self. The world self and the self actually there are two selves. The self of man, that means I'm a self. For example, I'm a self. Okay, I'm the lesser self, and the greater self is the Brahma. And I descend. I'm a part of that greater self. If you read Gita, you will find it that man is the lesser self. That means I is the lesser self of the greater self. That is the self of the world. That means everyone is a part of the creator. Everyone is a part of the creation, and the creator itself is a collective body. It was actually a thought. If you interpret it in this way, you will understand it better, or your students will understand it better. That if you say that the whole world is a body, and we are the organs of the world, we are the parts of the world, then of course there will be no adverse feeling, no feeling of opposition, no controversy, no enemies, no enemy nation, because everybody is a part of the creation. That is what Hinduism teaches us. Even the Asuras were created by God, the Devas were created by God. So even the Asuras are part of the God, of the same Brahma, of the same creation. Okay, so these lines are really or highly philosophical lines offered by Dushvanta in the context of the play, especially towards the end of the play, while he's talking to Matali.
Marichi and Maricha the same, or they are different? Here the spelling is M-A-R-I-C-I, and
yes,
in other places we find it M-A-R-I-C-H. So are they same person or they are different?
No, they are not the same person.
Daksa and Marichi, this Marichi, is that Sage Maricha, or is it someone else?
No, actually Marichi is differently pronounced as Maricha as well. And in the play, if you read the play, you will find your question is correct, that Marichi and Maricha, Marichi is also written as Maricha. But Daksha and Marichi. Daksha actually refers to Daksha Prajapati. Daksha and Marichi. Yes, Daksha and Marichi. Marichi and Daksha actually Shambhu. Should I tell you the myth? It's a long myth actually. It will be better if you contact me after the session, so that I can illuminate, because you see that I have to tell you the entire story of Daksha and Marichi, of Prajapati. These are from the Bhagavata Purana. The stories from the Bhagavata Purana. So it will be better if we discuss it after that class. Okay. My phone number is with Sanjeev. You may call me after 9 p.m. today. Okay. Thank you very much. Is there anything else that I can do for?
Gurpita, may I proceed?
Yes, Hriday, please proceed.
Thank you, Dr. Saurabh Nag, for such an enriching deliberation. Thank you for the support and solidarity you showed in accepting our invitation and in providing the lecture with such earnestness and elasticity. Your lecture not only illuminates different issues of Sanskrit literature, but also inspires us for further reading on the text from new perspectives. Thank you, sir. Here we end this session, and we shall be hopeful of seeing you again.
Thank you very much. Thank you.